Good morning everyone, myself Harita, Principal FSA, TTWRDC. Today I'm here to present a poem to you and I hope that you enjoy it and you learn it. Thank you. And the poem that I'm going to present today is A Requiem to Mother Earth, written by Onvi Kurup. Onvi Kurup, whose full name is Ottaplakka Neelakandan Velu Kurup, who was born in 1931 and died in 2016. And he is popularly known as Onvi. And he was graduated in economics and he was postgraduated in Malayalam literature. And in his lifetime, he was awarded with many prestigious civil and literary awards like Padma Shri, Padma Vibhushan, Gnanpeeth Award, Kendriya Sahitya Academy Award, Kerala Sahitya Academy Award, and so on. He was a literary legend in Malayalam history, and he wrote about 1500 songs in the movies and serials of Kerala. And the poem which we are going to learn today is A Requiem for Mother Earth, which means a requiem. A requiem means a mourning song which is sung in memory of someone who's already dead. And Onvi has written this A Requiem to Mother Earth to put forth his plea about the Mother Earth, how the human being has been exploiting the Mother Earth and what are the consequences of its exploitation. And let us get into the poem first. Before getting into the poem, we have an epigraph here which isn't mentioned in the textbook. This is a poem which is part of 4th semester English under Kakatiya University. And it starts with an epigraph, and this epigraph hasn't been included in the syllabus, but I want to share this with you. And in this epigraph, he mentions that a song of praise for this earth, for its surge of life, for poetry, the essence of its beauty. In the first lines of the poem, in the first lines of epigraph itself, the poet clearly is stating that it is a song of praise to the Mother Earth. And in search of life, he is beautifully going to recite a poem to Mother Earth and a beauty to its essence, beauty to the poetry. So this is what his epigraph all means. So let us get into the poem. And here is the first stanza of the poem, which says that, "Oh, still not dead earth, peace to you in your imminent death, written in my heart. These lines are for your funeral song and mine." Look at the first line. In the first line itself, he is warning us, "Oh, still not dead earth." What does it mean? It means that the earth is still not dead, but it is going to. Look at the second line. "Peace to you in your imminent death." Imminent, which is going to happen soon. "Oh, still not dead earth. Peace to you in your imminent death. I'm praying for your peace, for your death, which hasn't happened yet, but which is not far away. Written in my heart, these lines are for your funeral song and mine." Why has it mentioned in the bracket that, "for your funeral song and mine"? If not for the earth, do we have any life on earth? If earth perishes someday, if earth does not have its life someday, would we, the human being, we live on the earth? There's no chance. So in the first stanza itself, the poet is trying to tell us, if the earth is going to perish, if earth is going to die, then we, the human beings, are going to die along with that. And let us get into the second stanza, which states that, "Tomorrow, when you freeze in the shade of the dark flower of death, no one will be here to shed a last teardrop on your lifeless lips. I write this down for you, oh still not dead earth. Peace to you in your imminent death." So in the second stanza, he is stating that tomorrow. When you come to extinct, when you are about to die, in the shade of the dark flower of the death, in the shade of the luminous flower of the death, no one will be here to shed a last teardrop. Even I will not be here to shed a last teardrop for you. Because before your death, we, the human beings, will be died. To shed a last teardrop on your lifeless lips, I write this down for you, O still not dead earth. Peace to you in your imminent death. So in the first stanza, he has mentioned that I'm writing this poem as a funeral song, as a requiem to you and to me. And in the second stanza, he is stating that when it is about time that earth dies, even the human beings will not be here to shed a tear drop for your death. Because before your death, we all will be died by then. So before that time comes, before you die or before I die, I'm writing this. I'm inscribing this to you. I'm inscribing this requiem to you, the Mother Earth, in memory of your deeds. Let us get into the next stanza, which states that you are mother to the mother of the ancient 12 clans. You gave birth to children who would not live in harmony, watching one slaying the other to devour. You shed silent, invisible tears. Then by and by, they started eating you up in small bouts of revelry. You did not stop them, but endured it all in great patience. Those whom you breastfed, rolling up your green raiment, have all grown up. They had a thirst, their final thirst, to taste the sacred blood of your heart. They ripped open the embellished drape the sun had gifted his favorite bride, piercing your naked body with the fingernails. They drank the blood oozing from your wounds, and in that involved merriment. So in this stanza, the poet is stating that you are mother to the mother of ancient 12 clans. Ancient 12 clans means the poet, who actually belongs from the Malayalam, who actually belongs to Malayali. And in Kerala, we have a folklore about Parai and Vararuchi. Vararuchi is one of the wise men of Vikramaditya's court, who has married a Parai, a lower caste bride. And after the marriage, they left for a pilgrimage. And on the way for pilgrimage, they gave birth to 12 children. After the birth of every child, the Vararuchi used to ask Parai, does the child has a mouth? Then Parai says that, yes, the child has a mouth. Then Vararuchi says that, if the God has given mouth to the child, then God will feed it. So they left the child, they abandoned the child there itself and went on for the pilgrimage. This went on until they gave birth to the 12th child. So when the 12th child was born, when Vararuchi asked Parai whether the child has the mouth, then being mother, she could not abandon this child. And she, without looking at the child, she carelessly told her husband that, no, the child doesn't have a mouth. Then, in expectation that at least she could raise this child, if not for those 11 children whom they have abandoned, she could at least raise this child. But to her surprise, when she looked at the child was really didn't have any mouth. And Vararuchi, after knowing this, he left that child on a mountain to be a monk. So these 12 children, the sons of Parai and Vararuchi, in the course of time, they have built their own clans, and they, in the names of these 12 children, they have emerged 12 clans. And as being part of this, as the poet who's inscribing this poem belongs to Kerala, and he has incorporated their folklore, their history into the poem. You are mother to the mother of ancient 12 clans, those ancient 12 clans of Parayi and Vararuchi. You gave birth to children who would not live in harmony. The children whom to you gave birth, they would not live in harmony. As we look at the world, every nation or even states, not even states, we even fight among our villages. So he is stating that you gave birth to children who would not live in harmony, who would fight always, watching one slaying the other to devour, watching one slaying other, cutting other to greedily eat everyone up. You shed silent and invisible tears. When your children, the children to whom you gave birth to, when they are fighting with each other, when they are slaying with each other, you couldn't do anything. You could silently shed tears. Then by and by, they started eating you up. First, they started eating one another up, slaying one another up, and finally, they started eating you up. They didn't even leave you. Being their mother, they didn't even leave you. They started eating you up in small bouts of revelry. Revelry means in enjoyment. What do you mean by eating earth? Can we eat earth? The meaning of the poet here is eating earth means we have been using the resources from earth and destroying them. So this is what the poet meant here. After slaying one another, they started eating you up in small bouts of merriment, in small bouts of joy, celebration. You did not stop them, but endured it all in great patience. When they fought themselves, you could silently drop your tears. And when they started eating you up, even you couldn't do anything. You endured it with great patience. Those whom you breastfed, rolling up your green raiment, have all grown bare. A green raiment, a green cloth, the nature, the forest, the green raiment. You have raised your children, rolling up your green raiment around them, and you breastfed them. Those, the children, they are grown big today. They had a thirst, their final thirst. Initially, they started slaying one another, and then they started devouring you, and then they had a thirst, they had a greed in them to taste the sacred blood of your heart. They didn't stop just at exploiting you. They had a thirst of your blood of your heart. They ripped open the embellished drape the sun had gifted his favorite bride. They started embellish, they started uncovering your drape, your greenery. Like they have started deforestation, they have started cutting trees. The sun had gifted his favorite bride. As you can see, as all of you might have known, as Earth is the only planet with life on it, and with all kinds of life, like animals, plants, and everything. And this is the only planet where the life emerged, and the sun, the poet says that the sun had gifted his favorite bride a life, the greenery, a dream. Piercing your naked body with fingernails, they drank the blood oozing from your wounds. So this is what the poet wants to say. The children, your children, whom you have raised with love and with love and with a great patience and all, they started devouring you. They started exploiting you, and they have started drinking your blood oozing from your wounds. They have started cutting your trees. They have started making you naked by cutting trees, by deforesting it. But what could you do? The rhythm of death reverberates. The rhythm of death, the rhythm of the death of life, the rhythm of death of the earth has been resounding in the ears. The tale of the Greek youth here, in this, he has initially mentioned a folklore of the Kerala, where like Parayi and Vararuchi, and he is also integrating a great Greek like Greece history in it, where like he's stating about Oedipus. Oedipus is one of the kings of the Greece who unknowingly, unwittingly, who kills his father. Oedipus was abandoned child, and in search of the throne, in thirst of the throne, unwittingly he kills his father and he marries his mother. After learning the fact that there are son and mother, the mother commits suicide, and Oedipus, the king, who blinds himself but keeps on ruling the country. So, after committing a grave sin, to wash off the sin, one of them has committed a suicide and another one has blinded himself. After knowing the fact that they have committed a grave sin, they are trying to atone for their sins. But what about the humans? After knowing that the Mother Earth, which has given us the life, we have been exploiting it, we have been deforesting it, we have been chopping its trees and everything, we have been exploiting it very cruelly. But even though we know it's a sin, are we atoning for our sins? Are we planting any plants or trees? No. So this is what the poet wants to ponder upon here. Inadvertently wedding his mother is indeed old and stale. The Greek history, which has happened millions, like hundreds of years ago, and we already know that they have committed a sin and they have atoned for their sins. But what about the people now? Even though they know that they are committing the sins, are they atoning for their sins? No, not at all. The decades earlier history, although we know, but we haven't learned anything from that. These children of earth script a new tale dissolving their mother. The children of earth who has scripted new tale, the Greece tale of Oedipus, which I have just told you, it was a decades old tale. But what about the children now? Even after learning the tale of the Greece, the children of the modern age has scripted a new tale where after being aware of everything, they are still exploiting the Mother Earth, dissolving, stripping off their mother. They sell it in the marketplace and trade. What are they using the exploiting? What have they been doing after exploiting the Mother Earth? Have they been using it for their life? To carry on with their life? No. They have been exploiting the earth for their fun, for their enjoyment, to trade. As their boorish nails, those sharp axes, continue their fun, the burning eyes of the sun rain in flaming rage. The sun, whose bride is this earth, when sun has been witnessing all these, when the Mother Earth's children have been exploiting the Mother Earth, when the sun has been witnessing all these, he could only burn his eyes and rain in flaming rage. He couldn't do much about that. Going to the next one. Rain clouds seek water to drink, misty nights long for chill. And these rain clouds, which have been sent by the sun, they seek water to drink, misty nights long for chill. Spring is in search of a tiny flower, rivers long to flow. Whatever the sun that he has given to his bride, whatever the things that he has gifted to his bride, they have been searching for their destiny. But what about that? We have destroyed everything on earth. The rhyme of creation is all broken. The wheels of the chariot of life are mired in slush. As long as there remains a drop of the moonlight of awareness in consciousness, I, who was born from you and sustained by you, will retain those memories. With this stanza, the poet wants to tell us that the nature has lost its natural order, and the human beings are failing to acknowledge it. Even though the human beings are acknowledging it, they clearly know that if there is no earth tomorrow, then there will be no life on earth. Even though being aware of all the facts, have the humans stopped exploiting it? No, not at all. So enraged, the sun, he couldn't do much. So this is what the poet wants to tell us through this stanza. And going to the next stanza, wherein it states that, as honey and vayambu on my tongue, you are my maiden delight. You are my final joy. As the holy water drop extinguishes my flame, the sight of a tiny sun in a dewdrop on a blade of grass sprouted in you had ushered in me a splendid dawn. The deed of my desire gazed in the shade of your woods, like some emergent prophet winds walked on the surface of your sea. Look at the stanza here. Look at the first line of the stanza here. As honey and vayambu on my tongue. Vayambu is root of one of the trees. And Malayalis use this root to taste honey to the newborn child with this root. And they have a belief that if a child who tastes the honey along with this root, they will have a happy life. They will be very intelligent. And as it states in the first line, the poet wants to tell us that when a child burns, when a child takes birth, the first thing that the child eats, the first thing that the child has is not the milk of mother. The first thing that he has is honey. And whether this honey comes from? It's from nature. So, from the start of a life of a human being, since the start of a life, we depend on you. We take advantage of you. We use your resources. You are my maiden delight. You are my final joy. Whatever that comes into our life, the joy, the happiness, that all comes from the earth itself, that all comes from the nature itself. As the holy water drop extinguishes my flame, the sight of a tiny sun in a dewdrop on a blade of grass sprouted in you had assured me in a splendid dawn. You might have already seen the rainy days when we wake up in the mornings to find some dewdrops on the leaves of the plant. How do we feel when we look at that? We feel very happy. We feel very refreshed. And this is how beautifully you emerge. This is how beautifully you make our days. The sight of a tiny sun in a dewdrop on a blade of grass sprouted in you had assured me in a splendid joy. So here the poet is explaining the beauty of the nature. The deed of my desire gazed in the shade of your woods, like some emergent prophet winds walked on the surface of your sea. The poet wants to tell with this stanza that her beauty has captivated his imagination. Being poet, to write his poetry, the beauty of nature, everything, every little thing in the nature has captivated his imagination, has been source of his poetry. And it is like some emergent prophet winds walked on the surface of your sea. Look at the next stanza that he has written here. With cradle and lullaby for a thousand tender fruits, you are awake. You provide swings in a thousand groves and flutter atop the peepal branch. You stay there waving your flowery palms and coo like pigeons. Look at the first line of the stanza here. With cradle and lullaby for a thousand tender fruits, you are awake. You have witnessed thousands of lives, thousands, lakhs of generations. And let me tell you a fact here. The earth, we could say by like from geologists say that the life of earth started 4.5 billion years ago. And life on earth started some thousands of years ago. And in these thousands of years ago, you can imagine how many lives the earth might have witnessed, how many generations the earth might have witnessed. With cradle and lullaby for 1,000 tender fruits you are availing. You have been witnessing all the lives, all the generations on you. You provide swings in 1,000 grooves and flutter atop the people branch. You have been providing cradles, you have been providing swings to the children and even to adults. You stay there waving your flowery palms and cool like patience. You have been witnessing many lives, lives from many thousand years. But you are standing still. You have been witnessing all the lives. You have been supporting the lives on earth. So, with this stanza, the poet wants to tell us that the series of sickening magnificent images gives him external pressure. And these are the gifts that the nature is allowing us to use. This is what the poet wants to tell us here. Getting into the next stanza. In the rhythmic ripples of 1,000 rivers, you share my rapture. You shuffle and display your canopies with the flowering crowns of myriad forest trees. You scare with the hoot of an owl and cheer with the shrill of a crow. You preserve in your casket 1,000 colors to embellish the mind. You turn the evenings golden, disappear into the dark forest, picking up the dust, and carry upon your shoulders yet another thorn to awaken me and to feed me with honeydew. You hatch in again the nest of a halcyon forest and open it as gently as a home. Look at the lines of the stanza wherein it states that in rhythmic ripples of 1,000 rivers, you share my rapture, you share my enthusiasm, you witness every minute of my life, you shuffle and display your canopies, you show us your most beautiful nature with the flowering crowns of myriad forest trees, you scare with the hoot of an owl and cheer with the shrill of a crow. You do the both things. You scare us with hoot of an owl and at the same time you cheer us with shrill of a crow. You give us everything. You give us every enjoyment of our life. You preserve in your casket. You preserve in your treasury. These are the things which you preserve in your treasury. But you make us witness the beauty of youth. 1,000 colors to embellish the mind. In your casket, you save about 1,000 colors and which you could make us witness to embellish the mind, to broaden the mind. You turn the evenings golden, disappear into the dark forest, picking up the dust. You start a day and as the evening goes by, you disappear into the dark forest, picking up the dust and carry upon your shoulders yet another thorn. As the time goes by, as the night goes by, you disappear into the dark forest. But what? Does it stop there? No. The earth comes up with a dawn every morning, with a fresh dawn, with fresh colors, with fresh refreshments to the human beings. To awaken me and to feed me with honeydew. You hatch an egg in the nest of a halcyon forest and open it as gently as a pool. You offer us everything in you. You offer us, you make our lives very beautiful, very eternal. You make our life imaginative. You make our life colorful. And this is how you make our lives. This is how colorful you make our lives. This is what the poet wants to tell us through this stanza. Let us get into the next stanza. You are the lotus leaf support for my water drop like existence. I know you are in me in full measure. And these memories are indeed my elixir. The sweet truth of this fleeting existence glows for a moment on tip of your feather. You are the enchanting swan with music on her wings. Look at the lines here. You are the lotus leaf support for my water drop like existence. You might have seen water drops on the lotus leaf. The life of water drop on a lotus leaf is just few seconds, not even minutes. It's just a few seconds. But the water drop on that lotus leaf, it shines with some, when a sunlight falls onto that drop, it shines brightly. And I am such a water drop on a lotus leaf, and you are my lotus leaf. As I have already told you, the history of Earth comes from 4.5 billion years ago, and the life on this Earth has from thousands of years. And as the poet is comparing the life of a water drop on the lotus leaf, that the few seconds of life of water drop on that lotus leaf, as the life of human beings is at most at 70 or 80 years, or it would go up to 90 or 100 years in some cases. But when we compare the lifespan of a human to the life of the Earth, it would be a tiny water drop on the lotus leaf itself. But when a drop on the lotus leaf, it shines brightly, and you are such a support. You are such a support to the Earth is such a support to my water drop like life. I know you are in me in full measure, and these memories are indeed my elixir. What do you mean by elixir here? Elixir, we could say it as a pill which gives us life without any death. Okay? And the memories of this nature have been elixir in life. The sweet truth of this fleeting existence glows for a moment on the tip of your feather. As the poet mentioned, the life of a human being is like a water drop on the lotus leaf, which bright, like shinily brights. And the sweet truth of this fleeting existence, the existence of life, glows for a moment on the tip of your feather. You are the enchanting swan with music on her wings. So this is how you are to me. You gave me life. You treasured my life with yours. And you offered me all the things that are in you. And this is how you treasure me. And I treasure your memories in me. This is how the poet is describing the beauty of the nature. Let us get into the next stanza. Let that be gone. But the elixir that is you too has been defined by the pecking of the crow of death. While you move along the solar path as a castaway, with tonsured head and the bundle of humiliation, and the burden of your children's sins, with the flame of terrible pain in your half-empty mind, dreadful death is seeping into your nerves. In the previous stanzas, the poet has been telling us about the beautiful nature, about the things that the earth offers us, the beauty of the nature, the beauty of the earth, and what it offers us. And in this stanza, the poet it says that, let that be gone. The things that you offered us, the things that human beings have exploited, let that be gone. But the elixir that is you too has been defiled. Me, the life which was born from you, let it be gone. I don't have any regrets if I die one day. No, I don't have any regrets. But the elixir that is you, the Mother Earth whom I was born from, you are an elixir that is you too has been defiled. I might die. I don't have any regrets. But what about you? You are an elixir. You have to be standing there still to witness thousands of more generations. But what about now? As the humans have been exploiting you, you have been defiled by the pecking of the crown of death. While you move along the solar path as a castaway, you move along the solar path as an abandoned earth. As there is no life on any other planet, you are moving towards that. With tonsured head and the bundle of humiliation. With head without any hair. That means we have been exploiting the forest. We have been exploiting the earth. And you move in the solar system with that tonsured head, with bundle of humiliation. and the burden of your children's sins. Your children's, the human beings, have committed many sins, and you have been witnessing those sins, and you have been weeping for the sins which have been done by your children. With the flames of terrible pain in your half-empty mind, dreadful death is seeping into your nerves. As the humans keep on exploiting you, you couldn't even survive anymore. As you move in the solar system, lifeless, with half-empty-minded, with dreadful death seeping into your nerves. You move in the solar system lifeless, with the burden of the sins made by your sons, made by your offsprings. So this is how the poet wants to warn the human beings. And let us get into the last stanza of the poem. Oh, still not dead earth, this is your song of peace and death, written in my heart for your funeral and mine. As I shall not remain to shed the last tear drop on your lifeless lips, let me write this down. Oh, still not dead earth, peace to you in your imminent death, eternal peace to you on your impending death. So with this stanza, look at the stanza in here. Oh, still not dead earth, this is your song of peace and death, written in my heart for your funeral and mine. Because as the earth goes into extinction, we, the human beings, will be extinct too. So as you go near your death, even we, being human beings, we are near our death too. And here is a song, that requiem, a song of your funeral I'm offering you, and this is for your funeral and mine. As I shall not remain to shed the last tear drop on your lifeless lips, let me write this down. So before your death happens, I know my death would happen. I might not remain beside you when that time comes. So when I have my time, I have time in my hands, I'm writing this to you. When you are near your death, I may not be here for you to shed a last tear drop on your lifeless lips. Let me write this down. Oh, still not dead earth, peace to you in your imminent death, eternal peace to you on your impending death. So with these lines, the poet has ended the poem. In the poem, as you could see, in the initial stanzas, the poet has warned us that the life of earth is coming to an end. And not only its end, if we say that life of earth is coming to an end, it is a sign that human beings' lives are also coming to an end. In the initial stanzas, he is warning us. And then he comes to beautify the earth. He comes to beautify the nature. He explains the nature beautifully. How it has activated him, how it has enhanced him to write this poetry, how beautiful the nature is, and what it offers us, and what we have been doing to earth, how we have been exploiting the earth. And finally, as the poet couldn't do much, he wanted to express his grief to earth through this poem. So this is what it is for today. I hope you understood it well, and I hope you enjoyed the content. Thank you. Thank you so much for being with me in this one. Thank you.